Hello everybody, Dog Skeleton here, and today we're going to finish up the card reviews for the rest of the Un'Goro cards. I think we've got about 50 today, which were revealed on the live stream earlier, and now I'm a lot more excited for the set now that I've seen all the cards, thank goodness, because I did have high hopes for things after the last set. Now before we get to all the crazy cards on this page, of which there are some, oh my god, there are some I didn't even see yesterday. Oh my god. Okay. This should be interesting. But yeah, before we get to those, there's two cards on the front page of Hearthbone that we gotta knock out first, and then we'll go to the rest of those. So, first, new card, Ravasaur Runt. If you control at least two other minions, adapt. So, the idea behind this card is you probably want to play it with either the Lost in the Jungle Paladin spell, which is summon two Silverhand Recruits onto the field, which means turn one, you play two minions. Or you can play the Tabby Cat card, which gets you 2/1/1 adorable cubs. And then on turn two, you can play an Adapt minion. So this could easily be a 2-mana 2/5 beast, a 2-mana 2/2 poisonous, a 2-mana 3/3, or many other powerful combinations. In many cases, though, you wouldn't play it specifically on your turn 2, but later on, you just kind of flood the board with one-drop minions, which is what hunters seem to be all about this set. So obviously, it'll be a good hunter card if you are able to basically flood the board, play a lot of cheap minions. And beyond just this card, hunters are getting some really nice tool for that kind of playstyle. So I definitely think hunters are going to have a comeback this set, which... It's funny, because usually I hate hunters, but now I kind of miss them, just because they have been completely unplayed for, like, an entire set. And then we have this card, which I think people are overrating. I was reading some of the comments yesterday. Spirit Singer Umbra. So it's a 4-mana 3/4. After you summon a minion, trigger its death rattle effects. So, in a way, it's a lot like Bran Bronzebeard, which was an incredibly powerful card in... the Grand Explorers, or whatever it's called. And Britain Bronzebeard just went in tons of decks. But I don't know if this is quite at the same power level as Grand Bronzebeard. But one thing, why you're playing these cards is for their effect. And this costs one more mana, which is relevant. It does prevent a lot of options, especially when Tharzan is no longer in standard. So not quite as exploitable there. It is... decent if you are going to be playing a Death Rattle heavy deck. So it's like, imagine you're playing Shifting Shade in a Priest deck. You play this, maybe on the same turn as the Shifting Shade, and you get to take another card from their deck. It's like, it's okay. So it's like a 3/4 that you got to steal a card with. Maybe not as crazy as it could be. Like, one of the reasons that Bran Bronzebeard was so powerful is that you could combo it with cards like Kazakus. But there's not really many Death Rattle cards that come to that level of power, to be honest. That said, you know, it's still a pretty powerful effect. It's like all of your Death Rattle cards basically read Battle Cry and Death Rattle do that. Might be good with Jade Golem. I mean, that's true. You can summon some of those Jade Swarmers that rogues have. So it will become 2-mana, summon a Jade, and then Death Rattle, summon a Jade. Like a one attack, one health, Aya Blackpaw. Which sounds pretty good to me. But overall, I don't think this is going to go in the majority of decks. Kind of like Bran Bronzebeard would, or like the majority of control decks. But rather that there may be some niche uses for it. And the other thing to consider, really, is that... playing the super slow, super value game, I've noticed, kind of doesn't really win you that many matches lately. Like, if you play the net deck Reno Lock, yeah, you can do fine, but most of your deck is kind of tacked more towards surviving the early game rather than having these really late game cheese turns like Bran Kazakus, Youthful Brewmaster into Bran Kazakus, or something like that. Obviously, you want to play Bran twice, and requiring Emperor Tharzan in addition to that. There's only, the point I'm getting at is that there's only so greedy you can realistically play. And I think this set is going to be really tempo-heavy. It's not going to be the aggro set, but it will involve playing minions onto the board, kind of, I guess you could say, on curve a lot. I mean, we have the new elementals coming out, which seem to play very much like a Dragon Priest in a lot of ways. And then warriors are getting all these sick taunt minions. So rather than sitting around and just swinging with your weapons, warriors would also play minions under the board, which can eventually be enough of a threat. So the idea you're just going to sit back and play the Spirit Singer Umbra and get like, oh, three death rattle effects. I'm so outvaluing you. I don't think this is the set for that. But, you know, I could be wrong. I could be wrong. Everybody else who thinks it's an amazing card could be right. I think it's just kind of okay. It's an option. But it's not Grand Bronzebeard. Okay, now we can get to this page, which is going to be quite a lot of fun. So, first up, Fireplume's Heart. This card is going to define control warriors going forward. So, you play 7 taunt minions, which is really easy for warriors to do now, trust me. And then you get rewarded with Sulphuros. And Sulphuros should be down here. It's the weapon that Ragnaros wields. So 3 mana, 4/2 weapon, Battlecry, your hero power becomes deal 8 damage to an enemy. So you can basically become like the Major Domo Ragnaros without setting your HP to 8. So this is like if Ragnaros' hero power was actually good. So the weapon itself, it's like, okay, but really you're just looking for the hero power. I mean, the ability to smack a couple dudes, a 4/2 weapon for 3 mana is actually pretty good. But that hero power means that in the late game, you just kind of crush your opponent. So people against a quest warrior are going to be on a clock. Can you break through all of the warrior's taunts before he just smacks you down with the Ragnaros hero power? Which is quite different than how Control Warrior normally played, where they would just try to run you out of cards. But now they're eventually just going to kill you, which is kind of what I'm getting at. You can't just play that cheesy value game, because these quests will eventually give the proactive player the tools they need to close out a game. So I just don't think this, like, mind control or 4 copies of Brawl crap is going to work. Not in this set. But, yeah, I mean, prove me wrong. Prove me wrong. Next up, Direhorn Hatchling. 5 mana, 3/6 taunt. Death Rattle, shuffle a 6/9 Direhorn with taunt into your deck. Now, that Spirit Caller Umbra card, I think that would be pretty good if you could get Death Rattles like this off. But not, like, insanely good. That's still, like, a turn 9 play. But anyway, shuffle a 6/9 Direhorn with taunt into your deck. From the stream, I believe that is a 5 mana minion, so a 5 mana 6/9 taunt is quite insane. Of course, a 5 mana 3/6 taunt is pretty weak. That's just a Fen Creeper. But the thing is, how beefy do you really need your minions to be? It's just kind of to hold the line in Warrior until you kind of get Sulphuros. So it's not like you need to win all the value trades, and you can always play the Brawl when you start to lose. It's all about surviving till that Sulphuros. And when you do draw the 6/9 taunt, that's going to be tough to deal with, especially for, like, aggressive decks, like, let's say, Pirate. The Pirate Warrior just gets shut down by a 6/9 taunt. They have nothing that can answer that. So Pirates are going to have a pretty tough time this set. I think a lot of people are like, thank goodness for that. That said, the new Hunter archetype is kind of like, kind of aggressive, but aggressive that can keep going for, like, forever. So Giant Wasp, 3 mana, 2/2, Stealth Poisonous. This is kind of a new basic minion. In a way, it's not bad, because it's sort of like that Rogue minion, the 2 mana, 1/1 Stealth Poisonous. But, you know, this can't be clued up by, like, a Ravaging Ghoul or something like that. It's a lot harder to do 2 damage than it is 1. You might have a Volcanic Potion, but if you Volcanic Potion the Giant Wasp, it's like, so you traded 1 card for 1 card. Not exactly impressive. I don't know if this card's going to see any serious play, but having poisonous minions like this definitely is going to make your opponent think twice about wanting to put big guys onto the field, and there's quite a lot of poisonous minions in this set. So it'll be interesting to see how those play out. Maybe this would be much better in Arena. I think this would be a pretty good Arena draft card, to be honest. Play it in the late game, and your opponent just can't play their big minions, and maybe they have to Flame Strike just to remove some weak minions. Could be interesting to see how that turns out. Okay, here's a big card, Dinomancy. 2 mana, your hero power becomes give a beast +2/+2. So I don't know if every 100 deck's going to want to play this, but it's pretty powerful from what I've seen on the stream. And it does open up the option for finally being a control-ish hunter. The problem with control hunter was always that the hero power is aggressive. And if you're just trying to play defensively, it's a useless hero power, and that means a lot. But being able to buff your minions on the field every turn, kind of like playing a Mark of the Wild every single turn that you have extra mana to spare, that's really powerful. And it only costs 2 mana to pump this out, so it's cheaper than Shadow Form for Priest. And arguably, I would say it's a more powerful hero power, too. +2/+2 versus deal 2 damage. Great for making trades. So this should be a card that gets to see some play. I mean, if it's not seeing a lot of plays in the hyper-aggressive one-drop hunter deck, it'll definitely have some use down the line with maybe more mid-range decks, or maybe control decks. They have that new Hunter Legendary, the one that just auto-attacks any minion that hits the field. Weak against poisonous minions like Giant Wasp, by the way. But, you know, we might see something like a later-game Hunter deck. Who knows? This card just really, really changes the dynamics there. It's a very interesting card and quite powerful, too. Next up, Grievous Bite. So, 2 mana, deal 2 damage to a minion and 1 to adjacent ones. So it's similar to Power Shot, where that's 3 mana. I don't know if Power Shot's still playable, but Power Shot was 3 mana, deal 2 damage to 3 minions that are adjacent to each other. This drops the damage on the adjacent ones to 1. I think I would argue that this is probably better than Power Shot, because often when you're looking at a real board, there's only going to be like 1 minion that really needs that 2 damage, and then the other ones might be 1-drops. Like, say you're going up against a Pirate Warrior or something like that. They might have, like, a couple Patches or South Sea Buccaneers or something like that. And then they might have a 3-health minion or a 2-health minion. So you can kill the weak ones and damage/kill the big one for just 2 mana. So this is a really good removal card in general. It's amazing with Azure Drake, so let's kind of, for the sake of standard, thank goodness that that's rotating out. Because otherwise, like a 2 mana deal 3 to 1 minion and then 2 to the adjacent ones, that would be really sick. Similar to Swipe, in some ways, it doesn't hit every minion, but usually there's not 4 more minions on the board anyway. I think, in general, this is going to be a good removal card, a good card that just played in a lot of Hunter decks. I like it a lot. If there's not really any good spell damage minions left, though. I think it's fine without spell damage, though. And even if you are going to be playing the pretty aggressive decks, it's nice to have some cheap removal, too. Next up, Jeweled Macaw. It's kind of the babbling book of Hunters. It adds a random beast to your hand, 1 mana, 1/1. Obviously not too strong for tempo, but I think you would put this in a 1-drop hunter deck anyway, just because it's got good value. I mean, Babbling Book was put in a lot of mage decks. This might be a card that you play as you're starting to run out of stuff to play, and that's fine. There's also a card called Stampede later on, which is good with this as well, because the cheaper the beast, the more you can abuse the Stampede card. Okay, next up, Stonehill Defender. 3 mana, 1/4 taunt, discover a taunt minion. So it's total power creep on that ape from the basic set that no one plays seriously. A 1/4 taunt for 3 mana is not powerful. It does stop things like pirates pretty decently. But discover a taunt minion is pretty strong, so you could kind of think of it like Warriors have a spell called I Know a Guy, which discovers a taunt minion that costs 1 mana. So this is like a 2 mana, 1/4 taunt. Decent. Combined with a discover a taunt minion. So it's like 2 for 1. Individually, they're not that great, but combined, they could be decent. Obviously, this would be a lot better if you can find a way to buff its attack, like Inner Fire or something like that. And the fact that you have another Discoverer effect is pretty strong. Like, 2-mana Discover cards were like the Grimy Goons one, where you get a Hunter, a Paladin, and a Warrior card, and you get to choose one of those. Wasn't really played. You have Jeweled Scarab. You discover a 3-cost card. Wasn't really played, because the stats are pretty terrible on those cards. For 1 more mana, adding 3 more HP, I think that's reasonable. So it's not a super-powered card, as neutral minions usually shouldn't be, but it's an option. And if you go into Wild, you could discover 2 taunt minions, while having a decent taunt wall to begin with. So somewhere, sometime, I think this might see some play. Obviously, it's not bad with the Warrior Hero Power or cards like Bolster. But I don't think it'll be going in every deck. Cards like Tar Creeper are usually better for the defensive tempo play, because this does get run over by cards like a Warsong Charger Dude, the 4-mana, 4-3 that charges. Okay, next up, Onary Direhorn. This is a Warrior Beast, 6-mana, 5-5, Taunt and Adapt. If we say that the Adapt is a +3 health, then this is a 6-mana 5-8 taunt, which is really good. Alternatively, it could be a 6-mana 6-6 taunt, which is decent. It could be a 6-mana 5-5 Divine Shield taunt, which I think is a little better. Or it could be a 6-mana 5-5 Spell Immune taunt, which isn't bad either. It just seems like a pretty decent taunt minion to go in Warrior decks. I think it's probably more viable in Taunt Warrior or Quest Warrior than the other ones. But it's not bad. And it's definitely another card to stop aggro stuff. Okay, Stubborn Gastropod. 2-mana, 1-2 Beast, Taunt Poisonous. So, kind of similar to the Giant Wasp over there, where you're combining some of these keywords, but instead of like Divine Shield and Stealth, as we saw with Silent Knight, it's Taunt and Poisonous now. So this is a card that has to be dealt with. If they have to use a minion to go into it, it's going to die. I mean, as long as it doesn't have a Defiant Shield. I don't think that this is quite as good as something like the 2-2 Stealth Wasp. Part of the reason it's only a 2-cost minion. Because it's really easy to do 2 damage. I don't think it's too likely that you're just going to play this and magically kill their 8 drop. Like, it could happen, but realistically, I just think that's more likely than not going to be the case. It might be okay to draft an arena, though. Like, I think they'll have to Frostbolt it, or they'll have to lose something, and it will at least stop, like, a 2-drop minion in most cases. So it's not as bad as the stat line would give you the idea of, but if you're living in that dream world where you get to kill like a 6-plus drop, I think you're kind of pushing it. At best, really, maybe you'll kill a 3-drop, and that would be decent value for Arena. Next up, Primordial Drake. And this might be the only dragon in the set, but it's a good one. So it's a 4-8 taunt for 8 mana. Battlecry deal 2 damage to all other minions. So kind of like a Mega Whirlwind or a Revenge mixed in with a decent taunt body. Now, I don't think this will be enough to, like, keep Dragon Priest as the main Priest playstyle or anything, which is kind of the point of rotating Standard out. We don't want Dragon Priest again. And it's not, like, a super-powered card, but it's a decent removal. I guess you could kind of compare it to the Cold Blight, the Corrupted Seer, which was a 6-mana 2-3 Murloc that deals 2 damage to all non-Murlocs. This is probably better than that. That was 6-mana, but the stat line on this is way better. 4-8 taunt actually kills a lot of mid-game stuff, so being able to clear the board and then have a decent-sized body, which is a very anti-priest body, worth mentioning, it's not too bad. So it's an option for decks like Taunt Warrior or just any kind of control deck. Maybe Handlock or Reno Lock. Well, there's really not much of a Reno Lock anymore, is there? But Handlock could play something like that for sure. It's a little high cost though, so you probably don't want 2 in the deck, I think. Next up, Sated Threshadon. 7-mana, 5-7, Death Rattle, summon 3 Murlocs. I mean, 3-1-1 Murlocs don't really mean anything after turn 7, so this card's probably bad. you could say, well, it's like a 7 mana, 8, 10 in stats, but not really, and it's slow, and it's probably not a very good constructed minion, but it's okay in Arena, I guess. Next up, one of the craziest taunts. Oh my god, this guy has 11 health. 7 mana Tar Lord, taunt elemental, has +4 attack during your opponent's turn. So this is a 111 that's a 511 on your opponent's turn. A 511 taunt is insane for stopping things. Cards like this are just the death of Pirate Warrior. Like, jeez. Even if it is a little high in the mana cost. It's too bad this isn't in Priest, because then you could really abuse that stat line with Inner Fire. But being able to stall until you get that Zephyros out, or maybe you just have this as a taunt, and you play something tricky behind it, like a card that continually gets you value, like that 4-3 that +2/+2 to card in your hand, they'll eventually be forced to deal with this Tar Lord. And if they don't have, like, Twisting Nether, man, you gotta throw a lot of stuff into this. A 5-11... is just really tough to deal with. This will probably be a really good taunt minion, honestly. As long as you're playing defensively, not aggressively, this is strong. Weak to cards like Execute and that kind of thing, but I mean, you can't play around that forever, and hopefully you can burn those kind of cards out beforehand. I like this a lot. It's a mega tar creeper, but warrior specific. Next up, Stampede. And this is one of those cards I was mentioning earlier, one of the crazier cards in the set. Each time you play a beast this turn, add a random beast to your hand. So, it's kind of like Unleash the Hounds, but it's really good if you have a lot of one-drop minions. So, let's just say that your hand was something like the Jeweled Macaw and a Tabby Cat. So you play this, you play those two minions, you draw two more beasts. Because this only costs one mana, you've spent three mana, and you might be able to play another three, four beasts on top of that. I mean, if you continually get lucky with one drops. Which means the more like one drops you're playing, the better this kind of card is. And by the end of it, it might end up being like a one mana, draw three, draw four. Kind of like Starving Buzzard in a way, but way better because, I mean, would you really pay five mana for the 3/2 body? Yeah, this is like the better version of Starving Buzzard. So if you wanted to play like a cheesy summon lots of beasts, flood the board deck, a Stampede's a pretty good option, actually. Okay, Charged Devilsaur. 8 mana, 7/7. It has charge, but it can't attack heroes on the turn you play it. An 8 mana charge is not really that great. You could compare it to King Crush, which is 9 mana, 8/8 charge, and it doesn't have that can't attack heroes this turn thing. And King Crush isn't good enough to play, really. I think King Crush is slightly better than this. Well, with the exception of Dinomancy, you can make this a 9 mana, a 10 mana 9/9 charge that can attack heroes this turn. Which really isn't that much better. In general, I just don't think this is going to really make the cut. I like cards like Giant Sandworm better, but Giant Sandworm was always too slow to be playable. Probably not going to be like a great include in Hunter. But, you know, it is a neutral minion, so you might be able to consider it for something like Druid. So next up, the Druid quest. Jungle Giants. Summon 5 minions with 5 or more attack. Reward Barnabas. And Barnabas is gonna be down here somewhere. Yep. Barnabas the Stomper. 5 mana, 8/8 beast. Reduce the cost of minions in your deck to 0. Which means if you're playing basically like a ramp druid, the rest of your cards in your deck are free. Which is, or minions at least. Which is pretty insane. So the idea behind this Jungle Giants card, which you can probably guess just by looking at the quest, is you want to play a big stompy ramp deck, and you get rewarded pretty nicely with that. So as long as you have a lot of card draw, like Nourish in your deck, you could easily Nourish into 3 big minions, like Deathwing, and play everything the same turn. I guess I would be thinking more Deathwing the Dragon Lord rather than the one that kills all your own stuff, but maybe you play both. Whew, okay, Binding Heel, and this is a good priest spell. Restore 5 health to a minion and your hero. So it's a 1 mana heal 10, which is quite crazy. Ben Brode, was saying, oh, well, it's not quite like Flash Heal and better in every way, because if you try to do the Arcanine Soul Priest, it damages yourself too, but honestly, I think even though it hurts yourself, I would play 2 copies of this over Flash Heal. Maybe you play both. Although I think Flash Heal is rotating out. That was the Grand Tournament. Yeah. But if you just play this in a standard priest deck that heals, it's good against aggro, and it keeps your board alive, and that's just a ton of power for 1 mana. And there's going to be some ways to actually kind of abuse these cheap spells and priest coming up, so keep an eye out for this one. I think it's just going to see a lot of play. It's very powerful for a 1 mana card. Elder Longneck, 3 mana, 5/1 beast. If you're holding a minion with 5 or more attack, adapt. So it goes in perfectly with this Jungle Giants kind of thing. And you would think, well, if your quest is to summon 5 or more minions with 5 or more attack, you're going to have to play all these high-cost minions. And that's why they add cards like Magma Rager to the game. No, well, this is much better than a Magma Rager, because the Adept can easily make this a 3 mana 5/4, a 3 mana 5/1 Divine Shield, a 3 mana 5/1 with Stealth, or some other decent combinations. So it's actually a pretty solid minion if you're playing that style of deck, and probably most importantly, it builds up that quest counter from an early on gameplay. So that's going to be a good card. I would think maybe even core in something like that. It seems good enough to make it core. Because you want to get your quest out as soon as possible. You can't just wait around for like the Hunter quest to play 7 one-drop minions and win the game. Okay, next. Big Priest spell. Free from Amber. 8 mana. Discover a minion that costs 7 and more. Summon it. So similar to the Forbidden Shaping, but it's Discover, which means you get to pick which card you want. And it can be up to a 10-drop minion. So this is kind of strictly better than Forbidden Shaping if you're trying to play Forbidden Shaping on turn 8+, which in 90% of cases I think you would. You would go for that 8-drop and try to roll Ragnaros or Tyrian Forging. So being that this is better, I think this is a card that could see it into Control Priest decks. It says summon it, so I guess the Battlecry may not work. We'll definitely have to check about that. But like, say you get Deathwing. Does the Deathwing hit the field as a 12/12, or does it hit the field as a 12/12 that Battlecry destroys your hand? Important to note. Either way, I think this will be a pretty good late game card. And if you want to play Super Greedy, which probably I wouldn't recommend, you could play it in a Medivh deck, and then you would get 2 8-cost minions, which is ridiculous because of Atiush, of course. Okay, next up, Radiant Elemental, probably the best 2-drop for priests we've seen yet. 2 mana, 2/3, your spells cost 1 less, so it's like a Sorcerer's Apprentice for priests. It's also an elemental, so you can fit it into an elemental synergy deck. Kind of unexpected, I didn't think there were going to be many elementals for priests, but they're kind of playing that light elemental thing. And especially, as we'll see going forward, with cheap spells like Binding Heal that are going to benefit from already being cheap, making them a 0-cost spell could be even better for pulling off pretty crazy combos. So next up, Shell Shifter. It's a 4 mana 3/3 that transforms. Basically, choose one. Either a 5/3 with Stealth or a 3/5 with Taunt. So it's kind of like a flexible Sinjin Shieldmaster or a high-statted Jungle Panther for 1 more mana. Overall, though, I think this card is pretty trash. You might draft it in Arena, but I do not think it will make it into Constructed play. So, Lyra the Sunshard, and this is one of those cards that I was talking about, why these cheap spells are going to be crazy. Whenever you cast a spell, add a random priest spell to your hand, so it's a 5 mana, 3/5, bad stats. But if you can get to like your turn 10 play, you could easily add like an extra 2, 3, 4 cards to your hand. Now, once again, it's playing that dream scenario, so in the same way that, Spirit Singer Umbra is maybe a bit overrated, This is a strong value card, but it requires you to survive till that late game point, and in a meta that's going to have all of these quests rolling around, where the quests, if they get completed, will just roll over you, this might not be actually as good as it looks. And, I mean, remember, it's got like a 4-drop stats, so you're overpaying for it. And, that said, cards like Binding Heal definitely make it easier to get to that late game. Radiant Elemental is a really solid priest minion for the early game. So maybe we will see some play here. And maybe with cards like this, we can just play something like a Priest Elemental deck, very much like we were playing a Dragon Priest. Now, some of the elementals, like the giant firebomb guy. Okay, sorry about that. So, the, where were we? Right, so some of the elementals, like the giant firebomb guy, can deal 5 damage as a battle cry, 7 mana, 6/6. If you have cards like those in an elemental priest deck, I think you'll be able to hold the board for a while, at least. So, elemental light priest could be a thing. Is it going to be as good as the death rattle priest? Well, actually, I still stand by the point that I don't think that the priest quest reward is very good. Setting your health to 40, I don't think it's very relevant in a metagame where I think it's going to be all about tempo and, like, super aggro decks are out of the way. But also super control decks are not played, because if you try to play too greedy, you just die to quests. So setting health to 40, I think, is actually pretty bad as far as super quests go. But next up, Giant Anaconda, Death Rattle, summon a minion from your hand with 5 or more attack. This is a 7 mana 5/3 beast. I don't know about this card. Like, yes, you could get Deathwing off the back of it, which would be pretty good. But it's really expensive to play this card. Like, a Void Caller from the Naxxramas set was a 4-mana 3/4, and I thought that card was pretty good. But honestly, I don't think too many people are even playing it in Wild and Warlock at the moment, even though you could be like, I get a Jiraxxus out of my hand or a Doomguard for free. But this is like paying 3 more mana for that same effect. And yes, in Druid of all classes, you can afford to waste more mana. It could be okay. I mean, at least it does benefit towards the quest as a 5 attack minion. It's a lot better if you do have cards like the Spirit Singer Umbra in your deck, but Spirit Singer Umbra and a Giant Anaconda, I think that's kind of dreaming a bit. So I don't think Giant Anaconda is going to see much play at all. It's just too weak of stats. Even if its effect is really strong, you probably just want to play the big minion straight up. Like, just play your Ysera or something like that. Well, you want to play Ysera in that deck, but you get the idea. Okay, next up, Tortolan Forger, 2-mana 2/2, Battlecry Adamant minion with 5 or more attack to your hand. So it's sort of like Babbling Book, sort of like Dark Peddler. And I think it's pretty good, actually, because it's still a decent body, 2-mana 2/2, and you get a big dude in your hand. Hopefully it won't make your curve too crazy to play around, but kind of like your turn 2 play would probably be pass if it's not Wild Growth. So if you can fill that turn in with a minion to just survive long enough to actually play out your Druid quests, then that actually ends up being pretty good. I think this will definitely be played in Jungle Giants decks. I don't know if it'll make it into other kinds of decks, but it seems like a pretty solid card just straight up. Will kind of suck if you get Magma Rager, but that shouldn't be too often. And honestly, a free Magma Rager isn't that terrible. It's it dies to a ping, but it's also a big threat that kind of has to be answered. I mean, I'm not saying Magma Rager is good, but I'm saying a free Magma Rager isn't too bad. Okay, next up, Earthen Scales. 1 mana, give a friendly minion +1/+1. It's decent already. And then gain armor equal to its attack. So if you play this on a big attack minion like Giant Anaconda, you just made it a 6/4 and gained 6 armor. So this kind of card makes it a lot easier for this really slow late-game quest druid to actually survive. The amount of armor you're going to get off of this is pretty big. It's actually kind of comparable to Binding Heal in power, I think. Like, let's say you play this on something really big late game, like, let's just say Ragnaros the Fire Lord, because that's a really obvious example. Not that you can play it now, because Ragnaros is rotating out, but that would be like, you gain 9 armor for 1 mana. Crazy value. And that point in the game where, like, the kind of tempo decks are trying to push you out and make you die is probably really where you need this kind of power to come in. So the longer you wait, the more you'll get rewarded with more armor, and then you can just survive, maybe throw in a couple other armor cards or a Moonglade Portal, and you should be able to survive, I think. So pretty solid card. Could even be played in Token Druid, honestly. I mean, plus one as one mana spell isn't too bad. It's decent with Violet Teacher. So maybe... Okay, next up, Air Elemental. Wow, this is a Shaman card? I thought it was neutral. 1 mana, 2/1 Elemental, can't be targeted by spells or hero power. It's, like, okay, but can't be targeted by spells or hero power on weak minions is a lot less good than can't be targeted by spells or hero powers on big minions. Like, if your opponent wastes their turn pinging off a one-drop minion when you're playing a moderately aggressive or tempo-based deck, you're not that sad about it. And... I mean, putting that aside, it's just a 2-1. So, I don't think it's that good. I think it's just kind of like, it's an average-ish minion. I guess you might play it in Shaman just because it's an elemental, but it's really unimpressive. Yes, like, you have to be careful about one drops because they can easily be too powerful. Like, Druids have that 1-mana 2-2 Beast, which... You know, if it was a little bit stronger, it would probably almost break the game. If it was like a 3-health minion, like a Zombie Chow was, then that would be incredibly crazy. You have the Tunnel Trogs, which was a 1-3, but could scale out of hand. So you do have to be careful about these kind of cards, but I don't think this is nearly as good as something like Tunnel Trog. You might just play it in Elemental decks, because Elemental decks like to have those cheap Elementals so that you can trigger some of the Elemental effects. But like you see here, like cards like Igneous Elemental, it's not hard to get extra 1-2 Elementals to your hand at all. So maybe this won't even see play. I don't know. Next up, Volatile Elemental. 2 mana, 1/1. Deal 3 damage as a death rattle to a random enemy minion. This is a card that would be pretty good with Spirit Singer Umbra. That's true. Basically, it would become Battle Cry. Deal 3 to a random enemy minion. Which is like, it's okay. But you paid 6 mana for it and you get 2 crappy minions on the back of it. This is more of a board control card. Your opponent probably isn't going to bother trading into it unless they have an empty board and they Fire Blast. But yeah, you could easily use this to trade up into a 3-drop. But it's definitely only a defensive card. I don't know if it's going to see a huge amount of play. Maybe you play it an Elemental Priest or something like that because you're already playing defensively. It's not bad. There can definitely be cases where you can like 2-for-1, like... You trade this into Apaches, and it kills their Buccaneer off as well. That could be good. We'll have to see. I'm not going to say this is like a super good card, but it's an option to consider, definitely. Is it better than Doomsayer? I think is the real question. And in some cases, yes. And some other cases, no. Because Doomsayer is a really good stall tool. So next up, Open the Waygate. Cast 6 spells that didn't start in your deck. Reward Time Warp, and this is the mage, the mage quest. Time Warp, hopefully down here. Yep, there we go. 5 mana, take an extra turn. So it seems really crazy, but after thinking about it, because it costs 5 mana to play it and it doesn't do anything by itself, it really feels more like you take 1.5 turns. Rather than 2 full turns. I don't think it's actually that insane. Yeah, you can play it with giants, and then like you have a bunch of zero-cost giants, they hit the board, and then you time warp, and then you get to basically give them all charge by taking your next turn and killing them immediately. But that's a dream scenario, and I don't think it's going to happen much. It could be good in like a Freeze Mage, though Freeze Mages no longer have Frost Lance, but... Yeah, you could, like, I don't know. Well, what would a Freeze Mage even do for Burst and 5 mana now? Fireball? So, like, you could Time Warp and then, like, Fireball and then Time Warp and then do a 10 mana combo? I don't know. just kind of seems a little underwhelming to me at the moment. But it is the kind of card that you can probably find some really cheesy combos with, so maybe I can be proven wrong there. I think it's just kind of okay. Probably one of the weaker quests, though. Next up, Primordial Glyph. This is a card that goes right into that kind of quest, though. So 2 mana, discover a spell, reduce its cost by 2. To me, I kind of see that as a better Farsight. Farsight, you draw a card and reduce it by 3, but this, you kind of guarantee that you're going to draw something that's worth discounting, because you get 3 options. So you could get like a 5 mana Flame Strike or something like that, and, you know, spending your turn 2 drawing into that 5 mana Flame Strike rather than just Fire Blasting their face is actually pretty good. So I think Primordial Glyph is going to be a strong card, and even if you're not playing that Time Warp deck, I think this is still a card that you would include in a lot of mage decks. Next up, Fire Plume Harbinger. 2 mana, 1/1 elemental. Battlecry, reduce the cost of elementals in your hand by 1. In a way, I kind of think this is sort of like those Grimy Goon cards, particularly the one that the Paladin had, where you get like a 1/1 on the field and you buff your minions in your hand by 1/1. By +1/+1. This is kind of similar. By making them cheaper, it's almost like giving them a buff. But it also allows you to move your game plan forward, get your really big elementals out even sooner. Seems like a good card in a pure elemental deck. The more cards you can hit with this, the crazier it's going to be. I definitely think it's going to see some play in specifically elemental decks. And, you know, it might just be the case that every Shaman deck played from this point forward, if it's not Jade, is elemental. And maybe that's okay. But yeah, solid minion. Next up, Igneous Elemental. Death Rattle, add 2/1/2 elementals to your hand, and it's a 3 mana 2/3. So this is a good card for powering up your other elemental cards. In terms of value, it's not too bad either. Yeah, the 2/3 body is a bit weak. It needs to be, because that's a pretty strong Death Rattle effect. Good in elemental decks, probably not good in much else, but simply because it's kind of slow. But if you're doing Fire Plume Harbinger and you kind of speed up your cards, so this becomes a 2 mana minion that adds 2/1/2 elementals to your hand, then maybe it'll be fine, because those cards speed you up, so this actually becomes a reasonably paced card to play. Next up, Shimmering Tempest. 2 mana, 2/1 elemental. Death Rattle, add a random mage spell to your hand. So this is like Babbling Book, but it's an elemental, and it's also a Death Rattle effect. 1 more mana, 1 more attack. I would say putting the elemental tag aside, probably weaker than Babbling Book, because you want those kind of cards to be as cheap as possible. Though the fact it's an elemental might mean that it's good enough to play in elemental decks. I don't think it's bad. Maybe you just play both Babbling Book and Shimmering Tempest. I mean, why not? It feeds in really well to the Open the Way Gate card. So, like, you have those, and then you already have 4 cards towards that Time Warp. Yeah, you know, maybe if, like, your main deck is just strong enough, it doesn't matter that the Time Warp isn't that OP, because your deck just kind of builds right into that anyway, so you're okay with that. Like, if you just think of it, like, would you put Time Warp in your deck if it was a 5-mana card? Yeah, probably. So, if your deck already builds that kind of cards, then it might be fine to have that. Okay, next up, Stormwatcher. It's a 7-mana 4/8 Wind Fury. Seems pretty mediocre. I mean, usually Wind Fury minions kind of are. Its stat line isn't too bad. Not really abusable in like a one-turn kill type deal, but it's a decent minion for like using Flame Tongue Totem and killing a couple enemies off. Probably best in Shaman out of any of the classes, but I think it'll be more of an arena card, and at that, just kind of an average arena card. I don't think you would construct a deck with this at the moment anyway. Next up, new Shaman minion, another elemental, 3 mana, 2/4 taunt, Battlecry, restore 3 health, Hot Spring Guardian, and it's an elemental. For surviving that early game, a 2/4 taunt for 3 mana that also heals is pretty good. Sort of like an Earthen Ring Farseer, but I would argue Taunt in 4 health is better than a 3/3. So this is a pretty solid minion. You would put it in an Elemental Shaman deck. I think you would just play it. And maybe by having that, you don't need to play things like the Jin Yu Water Speaker. Okay, next up, Frozen Crusher, 6 mana, 8/8 elemental. After this minion attacks, freeze it. That's cute. Why would you, well, would you silence this or something? I guess a 6 mana 8/8 that can attack once every two turns isn't that bad. It's interesting. Or maybe you would put this in a Time Warp deck for mages? I don't know. I could see this card seeing some play. It's a really good arena card. There's no question there. Man, I would draft the hell out of this in arena. I think being able to attack once every two turns is fine, as long as you're trying to go for a value game. You could also reduce this cost with something like Fireplume Harbinger and then make this a 5-mana 8/8, which is crazy. I think somehow this will see some play in some pretty niche elemental decks, but yeah, it's a cool card. Next up, Tidal Surge. Deal 4 damage to a minion, you restore 4 health to your hero for 4 mana. So it's sort of like Jade Lightning, except instead of building up that Jade counter, you're restoring health. I think Jade Lightning is better in most cases. Pretty much all cases. I think the only way you would not play Jade Lightning over this is if you literally did not care about Jades whatsoever in your deck and you only wanted to put one of. I think restoring 4 health is better than a 1-1. I don't think restoring 4 health is better than a 2-2. So 2 copies of Jade Lightning might still be better than 2 copies of Tidal Surge if you're just looking for that removal. Maybe in the late game you don't care about those 2-2s and you just care about the elementals. It's another option. You could also play both. Maybe you could put this in like a pretty aggressive Shaman deck too, where it's like the restoring 4 health to your hero matters because you're just trying to burn your opponent to finish off the game. Maybe play both. It's not too bad. It's not a super powered card, but it is a decent removal card. Oh, yeah, you can't play this in a super aggressive deck. It deals damage to minions only. That sucks. Well, it's still not too bad of an option. Fireplume Phoenix, 4 mana, 3/3, Battlecry deal 2 damage. So, Keeper of the Grove is a 4 mana 2/2 now that deals to, allows you to silence a minion. Used to be played when it was a 4 mana 2/4 minion, but then it just fell way out of favor after they nerfed it. There's also that Hunter card, which is the 4 mana 2/4 that deals damage equal to its attack when it battle cries. And that's actually a pretty decent Hunter card. Unfortunately, Hunters haven't been very good lately, but I think they will have a comeback, definitely, this set. So, in terms of just putting this in your deck, I think it's probably okay. Like, 3/3 that deals 2 is a decent minion. It could trade equally into something like a Chillwind Yeti, so it kind of passes that test. And it's an elemental. So maybe you play this mostly because it's a decent 4-drop minion that also happens to be an elemental. It's good for tempo too, because the battle cry, it's like immediate damage. I think this will see some play somewhere. I would definitely draft it in Arena. It's a pretty good common. Okay, Meteor. Deal 15 damage to a minion and 3 to adjacent ones. So it's a 6 mana removal spell. Kills Ysera's dead. And it can also maybe get some value killing 2 or 3 minions even. It could be a pretty good control card. I think you would only put 1 in a deck because the situations where you would really need something as big as a meteor are pretty rare, but yeah, I think it's a solid removal card, much better than something like a Flame Lance for 5 mana. So that's pretty strong, actually. Yeah, if you think about it, like versus a Flame Lance, Meteor is way better. Way better. Maybe you would play 2 of this, actually, in a Control Mage? Sorta. I mean, it is sort of like a Flame Strike that totally destroys one minion. But maybe people will get smart and start playing around Meteor so their big minion is always on the left. So then at best you can only kill 2 minions. But killing 2 minions off with that is still pretty good if killing that minion means killing Ysera. Pretty fun spell. I like it. Next up, Primal Fin Champion. Yay, more Murlocs for Paladins. 2 mana, 1/2. Return any spells you cast on this minion to your hand. Oh, okay. Huh. So, that's how they're going to make the Paladin buff deck not suck. By putting minions that benefit off of that, right? So, Oh man, that's so weak to silence though. Well, it's as weak as to silence as like any buffed up minion with like a Blessing of Kings is. So you play Blessing of Kings on this on turn 4, or coin on turn 3, and then you get a buff. It basically becomes a 1/2 that draws a Blessing of Kings. But it has a bad stat line. It's kind of hard to say whether this card's good or not. If you're gonna go crazy and try to play the Paladin Quest, I think you would play this. And there are some pretty decent Murlocs for Paladins at the moment. So maybe Murloc Paladin that tries to build up to that Galvadon could be a thing? I don't know. It seems better than it did before, but there still aren't many good buff cards. So let me think about that. So turn 6, you play a 6-mana 5/6 with Blessing of Kings that draws you a Blessing of Kings. So, okay. Or you could just play a 6-mana 5/6. That's not good, is it? No. You could just play a 6-mana 6/7. Unless you play two buffs on this card, it's actually not good. So I think you have to play like a lot of really aggressive buffs like Blessing of Might or something like that, or maybe you need all that Murloc synergy, so you go for like the War Leaders and stuff like that. I'm a Fen Champion. I don't think that's very good. I think this is actually not a good card. So I guess the buff Paladin still sucks then, huh? We'll have to see. I could be proven wrong. I mean, as always. Okay, adaptation. 1-mana adaptive friendly minion. That could mean +3 attack, +3 health, +1/+1, give it poisonous, lots of other stuff. Because of the versatility, I think that's a good card. Oh, that's also a buff card. Okay. So this could be a cheap buff card that you put on a Primal Fen Champion. Maybe with the cheap buffs it can be played, but not if you're trying to go for like double Dino Scythe. Well, Primal Fen Champion Dino Scythe is actually a good combo for turn 10. I still don't think it's good, but I am seeing the possibilities. This is definitely a good buff for Paladins, though. It can be Blessing of Might, it can be +3 health. It's just very versatile. It can also mean basically your minion trades, your 1/1 trades into their minion, and it's like 1-mana removal, or like a 1-mana execute almost. Which a 1-mana execute is insane, because execute got nerfed. But of course, that's only 30% of the time. Devilsaur Egg. It's a 3-mana 0/5 egg, death rattle, summon a 5/5 Devilsaur. I guess this would be pretty good if you were playing it in a buff Paladin deck, because eggs need buffs, and once you have the buff on it, they have to kill it, and once they kill it, you get a 5/5 Devilsaur for 3 mana, which is good value. So, this could be pretty good. Also good in Egg Druid, so, any kind of buff your stuff deck, that's actually a good option, I think. Yeah, 3-mana 5/5 is good. Especially a 3-mana 5/5 that also gives you some health to work with when you do buff it up to trade some minions in. Okay, and next up, I did glance at this card before, but 4-mana 3/3, the Vorax. After you cast a spell on a minion, summon a 1/1 plant and cast another copy on it. So it's sort of like a slightly cheaper version of the Dejean of Zephyrs, which, I think is rotating out because that was the League of Explorers, right? But yeah, if you have like adaptation, so you can get like a 1/4 plant for free, and then so it would be like a 4-mana 3/6 that also gets you a 1/4 plant for two cards. It's okay. I think you would only play this in like buff Paladin, if anything. And you do have to go like really heavy into buffs for this to be worth it. Same with Primal Fen Champion. If you're willing to go all out on buffs, these cards become playable, but otherwise they are trash. Okay. Molten Reflection. 4-mana. Choose a friendly minion, summon a copy of it. That's a really good card. You could say, yeah, you could play that in that Time Warp Giants deck. So you just copy a giant for 4 mana. So you, four mana 8/8. Kind of like playing the copy of friendly minion stats for 4 mana, which Handlox would play. But this also gets you the effect behind it. So if you could play Ragnaros like in Wild, that would be crazy. You just duplicate a Ragnaros for 4 mana. Yeah, that's really good. Though maybe it's not super, super crazy, because if you're just going for the stats like a giant, you can already do that. All you need to do is play the four mana taunt that copies of friendly minion stats. But there's more versatility here. You can copy interesting effects, like I guess you could copy the Vorax or something like that. Could be cute. Which would also get you an extra plant, which you would copy as well. So you could copy a lot of stuff. I don't know. That seems really gimmicky. Yeah, this is a card that will have some flexibility and interesting use in kind of combo decks going forward, where you build the right board state and then you just win because you Molten Reflection what you want. Like copy a Ysera, for instance. Emerald Reaver, 1 mana, 2-1. Battlecry, deal 1 damage to each hero. So it's kind of like the old Leper Gnome, right? Where you're trying to just deal extra damage to your opponent. If Leper Gnome dealt out 1 less damage, would it be good? Probably only in Hunters. So you could play this in a Hunter deck because it's a 1-drop, and they're all about the 1-drops right now, because it's a beast, because it's aggressive and it has 2-1 stats. It's not a super great minion, but I think this might make the cut for aggro or quest hunter decks, let's say. It's not really aggro anymore, it's just kind of, you're building up to that quest, and then you flood the board. Okay, and now we have even more cards. Oh my god, guys. This video is so long. Okay, Cruel Dinomancer. 6 mana, 5-5, summon a random minion, you discarded this game. Wow. That's actually really good. So, discard Warlock, they're definitely adding some minions in that are going to be good for that, and that is a really powerful effect. This is kind of like the Menagerie Warden that Druids have. So let's say you discard your Jiraxxus and you summon a free Jiraxxus. I mean, you're not playing Jiraxxus in a discard Warlock, but you summon anything with that and you get good value. So that's just a really good card in discard decks. Yeah, just it's a power card. It's like a Menagerie Warden. I think you would play that. Probably 4 or 5 stars out of 5. I don't know much else what to say about it. I guess you can combo it with Spirit Singer Umbra for that turn 10 cheesy crap. Yeah. I mean, here's the thing. It costs 4 mana. Like, are you really going to get all these crazy combo effects? I think you're living the dream if you really think Spirit Singer Umbra is going to be that good. But hey, prove me wrong. Okay, next up, Bittertide Hydra. 5 mana, 8-8. Whenever this minion takes damage, deal 3 damage to your hero. So you could die by playing that, but I think more than likely, if you're at 30 health because you're the aggressor, you'll be fine. So 5 mana, 8-8. Yeah, I think I'd play that. This seems really good in something like Tempo Hunter, or probably you wouldn't play this in Druid because Druid's too slow. But if you have health to spare, I think on average you would take about 9 damage by playing this. Probably not too many cases where they can literally kill you by dealing 1 damage 8 times with like 3 copies of Arcane Missiles. I think the risk is worth the reward. Just play it in an aggressive Hunter deck. A 5 mana 8-8 is huge. If they can't stop it, they just lose the game. So I think more often than not, if you play this on turn 5, you win rather than lose. The cases where they can just outright kill you because you played this are probably a lot less than you can just kill them because it's an 8-8 in their face. But you might want to trade some of your early game 1-drops to kind of protect this in some cases so that you don't get overrun. But yeah, 5 mana, 8-8, it's like the return of Fellreaver, basically. This is like Fellreaver. Like, you play this to end the game, and if you actually needed to draw more cards, like with Fellreaver, then you're going to lose because Fellreaver just destroyed your deck. And if you need more HP to survive, this is going to get you killed. So you only play this in aggressive decks. But good option for Hunters. 8-8 for 5 mana. Pretty sick. Next up, Chittering Tunneler. 3 mana, 3-3 beast. Man, Curator is going to be good this set. Battlecry, discover a spell. Deal damage to your hero equal to its cost. Okay, so you grab Twisting Nether. So it's a 3-3, draw Twisting Nether, take 8 damage. I'd play it. I mean, it's risky, and you'll probably die sometimes, but maybe go for a cheaper spell, like a Soulfire or something like that. Drawing a Soulfire, totally worth it. I mean, it only costs one health anyway. Maybe this is too greedy for, like, a heavy control deck, but it could be a good hand refiller for average decks. Man, if Reno were still there, that would be really good. Is there going to be another way for, like, Handlock-style Warlocks to keep themselves alive? That's kind of the question here. I think it's kind of risky to play two of, though. You need a lot of healing, but I do like the card a lot. I am kind of a value player. But you might make... going back to Spirit Singer Umbra for the fifth time, you might think, like, oh, then why am I not all about Spirit Singer Umbra? Well, I think in recent months, I've just kind of became a bit more realistic and just seeing how if you play Curve Stone, often that just beats out the really high-value Reno decks or something like that. Just by, like, I played on Curve, and it's turn 6, so you can't do your combos, so you just kind of die, right? That said, I hate Pirate Warrior, and I refuse to play Pirate Warrior. Okay, next up, Ironhide. 1 mana, gain 5 armor for Warriors. So, it's actually a block, but you pay 2 less mana, but you don't have to... I mean, you don't get the draw. Seems pretty decent. I wonder if there's, like, a warrior deck that could have abused cheap spells. Maybe you play that with Yogg-Saron. Could be a good survival card. I don't know if it's really necessary with all the taunts, though. Like, you could play this as an alternative to playing the taunts if you'd rather play spell-heavy. It's pretty good value. You can shield block on the back of it. The only question is, how are you going to maintain your hand size? That's the problem with this card. So in a lot of cases, shield block would be better, but this is an interesting option, and I think it's reasonably priced. Definitely Binding Heal is a little better, though, but, I mean, you can't make armor too powerful, because shield block's always a thing. Okay, Nesting Rock. 5 mana, 4/7 beast. If you control 2 other minions, gain taunt. So this becomes a 5 mana, 4/7 taunt. And it's always a 5 mana, 4/7 beast. Right? Hold on. 5 mana, 4/7 beast. Is that high stats? Yeah. So just... That's like just power creep there. Like, so the typical 5 drop is a... Oh, well, actually it's a 5/6 now. But a lot of the old ones were like 4/6s. Though they usually did come with an effect, like Spiteful Smith. So it's just kind of a different stat line at the vanilla, the value vanilla stat line, like Pit Fighter. But you would play this in the aggressive board flooding Hunter, probably. So, well, but would you? Because you already have Bitter Tide Hydra. I guess it depends on what way you want to build that deck. Or maybe in a Shaman, too. A 5-mana 4/7 taunt is pretty solid. But you could even consider it in, like, a Zoo Warlock, too. 5-mana 4/7 taunt in Zoo seems really good, too. I mean, what's a Doomguard? A 5/8 charge that discards, too? Yeah, that's just a good stat line. Lots of options. If you have anything that's tempo-heavy, this becomes a pretty good option. I actually think this might see some play. And, once again, it's a beast, so you can play it in Curator. Man, Curator is getting so many good beasts. It's insane. There's good Murlocs, too. I don't know if this one is. So, Rock Pool Hunter, 2 mana, 2/3, battle cry, give a friendly Murloc, +1/+1. Yeah, that's a solid Murloc. Even as a good, a decent stat line, the vanilla 2/3 stat line, but it becomes basically 3/4 in value. It's like a Shattered Sun Cleric. But for 2 mana, that only works on Murlocs. That's actually a powerful Murloc card. I think this is going to be seen in all Murloc decks going forward. That's really strong. Emerald Hive Queen. Your minions cost 2 more, and this is a 1 mana 2/3 beast. Huh. I guess you would play this as, like, the final card and a Stampede or something like that, where it's like, well, you're okay with your minions costing more because the game's going to only last one more turn and you only have 3 cards in hand. Or you could play this in... maybe it's even better in, like, a control deck where it's like you play it like a Zombie Chow and then your turn 2 is always something like discovering a spell, playing spells, to gain value, like mage or priest or something like that. And then you just play this as a zombie gel. It's interesting. I could see it in... It probably wouldn't go in the aggro deck, actually. So maybe this is just a good control card. Kind of like a Doomsayer, but shuts down early game plays. Really good against Pirate Warrior. I think somehow this will see some play, just because it's got a really good early game stat line. If your turn two is like Life Tap or Discover a Spell, or your spell heavy deck in general, this is a card you can consider. It's got good stats. Biteweed. That said, though, you won't be able to really play any more minions until this dies, so you better have a lot of spells. Biteweed. 2 mana combo, 1/1 for rogues. Combo, gain +1/+1 for each other card you've played this turn. Okay, so it's a bad Edwin Van Cleef, right? So 2 mana Edwin. So let's say you were like, Backstab, Deadly Poison, Biteweed on turn 3, so you get a 2 mana 3/3. Seems pretty underwhelming. I guess the Rogue Quest is all about playing... No, it's actually about playing 4 copies of the same card. Wasn't there a card that was like, the more cards you play this turn? Oh yeah, the 4 mana Rogue Legendary. If you play four more cards in the same turn, it revives itself. I guess you could play this in that kind of deck, but for the most part, this kind of isn't that good. It's just kind of okay. If you play 2 cards, you make it a 2-mana 3/3, and it's alright. A 2-mana 3/3 isn't even that insane. It really needs 3 more cards to be good. Maybe what you do is you play this as the 4th card on the revival turn. So you play like 3 cards like Shadow Step, Backstab, Deadly Poison, Biteweed, and then that gives you a 4/4 for 2 mana, and it revives your 5/3 shares in the Corpse Flower. And then that's like, it's okay, but it's kind of gimmicky. I don't think it's very good still, but we'll see. Okay, new warrior spell I haven't seen before. Sudden Genesis, 5 mana, 7 copies of your damaged minions. Okay, so they already have Blood Warriors in the game, which is 3 mana, add copies of your damaged minions to your hand. That was not played at all because it was way too slow. You couldn't even make Patron work with it, too slow. But I guess now you're going to have a lot of really big taunts. So maybe in a Taunt Warrior deck, where you're playing kind of tempo-heavy and you just have all these taunts that they don't want to play into, you could play Sudden Genesis and get like a new Tarlord or something like that for 5 mana. Maybe this is playable. I think I would rather play Blood Warriors. Is Blood Warriors still playable in Constructed? I don't know. I think if you're going to do that Tarlord stuff, I would rather have the Blood Warriors in the deck, but I don't know if it's going to be playable. It's really slow card, Sudden Genesis. It's probably unnecessary. I'm going to go out on a limb and say this isn't going to see play. Next up, Tar Lurker. It's another Taunt Tar minion. So this is 5 mana. It's a 4/7 on your opponent's turn with Taunt, and it's a 1/7 on your turn. Or you could have a Nesting Rock, which is always a 4/7 with Taunt if you have 2 or more minions on your side of the field. Yeah, this is better for control decks. So, would you put this in a hand lock? Yeah, I think you would, just because it slows the game down. Overall, it's basically a control card, and that's about it. It's elemental. I don't think elemental warlocks is going to be a thing. Yeah, just kind of a stally card. It's better than a Doomsayer. So, or you could play it out as well as a Doomsayer. But the question is, as a handlock, what are you even building up to anymore? Are you going to try to play the discard handlock? Where you're still trying to go for that infinite portal? Maybe that's what you do now. But then why not just play the aggressive zoo version, where you're playing lower curve and earlier tempo, earlier to get the quest out, earlier to win the game? I think it's a solid taunt option. I'll say that. Next up, Razor Petal Lasher. 2 mana, 2/2, rogue plant. Rogues are getting all of those plants now. Add a Razor Petal to your hand that deals 1 damage, Battlecry. So I'm guessing that's either 0 mana or 1 mana. Probably 0 mana, deal 1. So it's a 2-2 for 2 mana that deals 1 damage. So it's kind of like a Cruel Taskmaster that you can save. Okay, I'm actually seeing where this card is going. So you play it in the plant deck. It's a 0 mana spell that deals 1 damage. And a 0 mana spell that deals 1 damage is really good in Rogue because you could play it with Gatchasand Auctioneer. And it also revives your stuff. It also buffs your Bite Weeds. I guess in that style of deck where you're trying to play a lot of cards in one turn and you're trying to build off of that, you play Edwin Van Cleef, you play the Bite Weeds, you play Shares and the Corpse Flower, and you definitely need Gadgetzand the Auctioneer. So it's like a new version of Miracle Rogue. You play this kind of stuff, and it's actually pretty good. So if we kind of think of it like a 2-mana 2-2, add a coin to your hand, that's good. That's actually good. So this is a good card. In Rogue, it's only good in Rogue, though. Which is fine, because it's only a Rogue card. Next up, Razor Petal Volley. Add 2 Razor Petals to your hand that deal 1 damage. Okay, so you can just fill your hand up with some of those zero-cost Razor Petals, and then later on you play the Razor Petals, or you can even play this in the same turn, and that's 3 spells in 1 turn. Okay, right. Now I'm seeing how this is a thing. So, in order for Biteweed or Sharazin to be gored, you need to play this Razor Petal crap. So you get all these zero-cost spells. You can draw a bazillion off a Gadgetzand Auctioneer, or you can just do a big combo churn. Great with Edwin Van Cleef. Yeah, okay, I see it now. This is actually a decent archetype with this kind of stuff going on. So it's like super Miracle Rogue, in a way. Next up, and this is a... what class is that? Paladin? Okay, 7-mana Vine Cleaver. 4-3 weapon, after your hero attacks, summon 2/1/1 Silverhand Recruits. I like it. So, it's kind of a slow weapon, but the idea here is you're playing a Silverhand Recruit deck. There's that one minion that adapts all of your Silverhand Recruits. If you're playing Wild, you can do the Quartermaster stuff, and this would be really good with Quartermaster. Just in itself, a 4-3 weapon is probably worth about 5 mana. If we're talking about, like, a 4-3 weapon that would be okay for Arena. So the fact that you're getting about 6 Silverhand Recruits off of that makes it pretty good for the value game. The question is, though, are you going to play that over the Paladin Quest? And you might, because the Paladin Quest isn't really that impressive. But if you are playing this kind of Silverhand Recruit deck, is it even good enough in the meta? I haven't really seen anything that would make it super crazy. The Adaptive Recruits is good, but is it good enough? This card might be better in Wild than it is in Standard at the moment, though we haven't seen all the cards yet, or at least I haven't. So let's go ahead and move forward. Okay, 3-mana, Humongous Razorleaf, 4/8, and Silence Priest gets better. Wow, a 3-mana, 4/8. That's not bad. So you have like the Ancient Watcher, 2-mana, 4/5, the Humongous Razorleaf, the 7/7 rotated out of Standard, the giant Colossus thing that could only attack if it was the only minion on the field. Well, I guess this kind of replaces that decently. You could also just give this taunt with a Sun Fury Protector, a big-ass force for a taunt that can't attack. It's pretty fine. So, if you want to play, like, Taunt Warlock or just an old-school handlock, that it's like, okay, you have to go through all this stuff to get to me, and eventually I'm going to have a game plan where I win, then maybe you can play that. I think this is playable if you want to play a slow wall-building deck. A 4/8 taunt for 3 mana is... I mean, a 4/8 that can be a taunt for 3 mana is a big deal. And it's also good with Silence Priest, for sure. Next up, 10-mana Ultrasaur. It's a 7/14. It's better than the 10-mana 10/10, but this is an arena card only, and you would probably only take this if the other options were pretty bad. Because currently, here's the thing about Arena. If you're playing a really good Arena deck, it doesn't even always go to turn 10. And you don't want a dead card in your hand. It's not as good as like a North Sea Kraken either. Which, come to think of it, is North Sea Kraken still playable in Standard? It might be rotating out. But it's got an okay stat line. But it's only okay in Arena. You would never play this in Constructed. I think you would never play this in Constructed. No, there are better cards. You could just play like Deathwing, Dragonwood. Play your big 10-mana Legendaries, not this. It's probably like 4 out of 10 in Arena and 0 or 1 out of 10 in Constructed. So it's just a filler card. Bright-Eyed Scout, 4 mana, 3/4. Draw a card, change its cost to 5. Okay. Interesting. So if you're playing a really big deck, like Ramp Druid, for instance, and you make it so your deck's more than likely to draw a lot of 8, 9, 10 cost cards, then this could mean your turn 5 could be Yasharge or something like that, or Deathwing Dragon Lord. So if you're playing that super big greedy deck, this is actually a good option. It's kind of like Naga Sea Witch, but it's better because A, it draws a card, which is nice. 4 mana, 3/4 draw card is actually pretty powerful. But B, it reduces the cost for those big decks. So this is a good card for big decks. Yeah, I think this will see some play, specifically in Ramp Druid or anything else that's that big. I like it. Oh my god, 12 more cards, guys. Eggnapper, Death Rattle, summon 2/1/1 Raptors, and this is a 3 mana 3/1. So you put the stats and it's a 3 mana 5/3. That's not great. It's okay in Arena. 1 health minion, not great. 2/1/1 Raptors, not great. Probably too weak to see in Constructed. I would say definitely. And you would draft this in Arena sometimes, but only when the other options suck. It's like a below average card. And maybe it's average at best. Okay, 9 mana, Great Mastodon, 6/10 Taunt. A 6/10 Taunt is kind of better than a 7/14. So let's see. Bog Creeper was a 7 mana 6/8 Taunt, I think, and this is a bigger Taunt. You might play it in like a Ramp Druid, but are there better options for a 9 mana minion? Or is the Taunt just so important that you need to survive? You would play Slowgoth the Slitherer over this as a 5/9 Taunt with Can't Be Targeted by Spells. Probably too weak to play in competitive decks. A okay Arena card if you really need to play that slow game while surviving. The stat line isn't too bad. It's not terrible. It's like average. Okay, Pterodax Hatchling, 3 mana, 2/5 Adapt. So that means it can be like a 3 mana 5/2, a 3 mana 2/5, a 3 mana 2/2 Poisonous, a 3 mana 2/2 Stealth. I think it's a decent Arena card, probably not good enough for Constructed. Maybe if you go back to Wild, you would play this in Brand Bronzebeard, because then you can make it like a 5/5 for 3 mana sometimes, but probably not. I think you would draft this in Arena quite often, but not so much in Constructed. Steam Surger, 4 mana, 5/4 Elemental. Battlecry, if you played an Elemental last turn, add a Flame Geyser to your hand. What is a Flame Geyser? I don't think we've seen it. Oh wait, yeah, it's that 2 mana spell. So, I don't remember exactly what it does. I think it's like 2 mana, deal 2 damage, add a 1/2 Elemental to your hand, something like that. So it's kind of like a 4 mana 5/4 draw a removal if you're playing an Elemental deck. So you would play this in an Elemental deck because its average stat line that draws you a card is good. Yep, not too much else to say about that. It's a solid minion for Elemental mages. Obsidian Shard. What class is this? Costs 1 less for each card you've played from another class. So is that a rogue? A rogue weapon? I think that's a rogue weapon. 4 mana, 3/3. So you're playing like Swashbuckler, Burgle type deck, and it could easily be like a 0 mana, 3/3 weapon? Okay, yeah, if you're playing that kind of steel deck, this is a pretty good weapon. Better than like a Assassin's Blade. I think a 4 mana, 3/3 is better than a 5 mana 3/4 just straight up. So this is just better than Assassin's Blade, but it's way better than Assassin's Blade if you happen to be stealing some cards. Which, pretty much any control rogue that kind of wants to steal lots of cards, or mid-game rogue wants to do. So easily equipping like a 0 or 1 mana 3/3 weapon, I think that'll be pretty good. Especially if you can, maybe you play with Lucky Dude Buccaneer, because that's already a 3-attack weapon. Or does Lucky Dude Buccaneer require a 4-attack weapon? I think it's 3-attack. So yeah, you reduce the cost of some cards, you get this out there, and maybe you turn six play a 0 mana 3/3 weapon plus a 9 mana Lucky Dude Buccaneer, and that could be a good tempo based deck actually. This is a solid card. Less good in Arena, but still decent in Arena. Next up, 5 mana Warlock spell Feeding Time. Deal 3 damage to a minion, summon 3 Pterodaxes. So okay, let's kind of think like luck. Muster for battle that deals 3 damage to a minion but costs 2 more mana. It's okay at best. Maybe you would play this in Zoo. Kind of like a what's it called? Implosion, but without the randomness. And then you combo that with cards like Nesting Rock and just Zoo. But it still seems slow. I don't think it's a great card, but you might put it in some decks. Maybe it's a one-of. Or maybe you put it in a control deck just as like a kind of crappy removal. I mean, Warlock spells always have kind of sucked. Probably won't see a lot of play though. A little better in Arena. Blood Bloom, 2 mana. The next spell that you cast this turn costs health instead of mana. Okay, so it's like a tempo play. You can siphon soul with this. It's like a 2 mana innervate that deals 6 damage to you. Could be decent. You might put like 1 or 2 copies of this in your deck. I'm not exactly sure what you would play this with. Maybe you play with Doom, actually. So Doom, you just take 10 damage and you get to draw a lot of cards and then you have 8 mana left. That could actually be good. The problem is, are you going to be able to survive after you just took 10 damage? This can potentially be really powerful. Hallucination. Discover a card from your opponent's class, 1 mana. 1 mana discover a card. Works with his Obsidian Shard. Works with that Ethereal Pillager. If you want to play that kind of card, that kind of setup, this will be a good card. Just in Rogue in general, it's good for Miracle decks. You get to choose 1 of 3 cards. This might just go into a lot of Rogues. It's a good filler card for like turn one and good for Miracle as well. Envenom Weapon. 3 mana, give your weapon poisonous. That's interesting. So it means that your rogue weapon can kill anything. That seems good. Like, you could just play this with the hero power. And then it's like 5 mana with the hero power, 1 card, and your attacks now kill any minion. Yeah, you'll take a lot of damage, but in terms of tempo, that can be pretty crazy. That just means like you can stab through all of the giant taunts that a warrior puts in your way easily. This is a really good card against warrior taunt decks. Sabertooth Stalker, 6 mana, 8/2 beast with stealth. This card is kind of on the crazier side. If they can't remove it is 8 damage to the face. I'm not really sure what to make of it. Like, 6 damage removal. I think you usually want this to go face. Maybe it's good with Menagerie Warden, where you're playing like a burst damage beast druid deck where you just try to finish the game in one turn. So you copy another Sabertooth Stalker and it's at least 16 damage to the face that they can't stop unless they have a flame strike. Really weak to things like Meteor though. Probably not good enough to really play in Constructed, honestly. Like there's just too much risk of you getting destroyed. And by turn 6, there's a lot of ways to deal 2 damage. Probably more of a filler card, but I do see the potential for some crazy niche applications. Maybe like with Tundra Rhino, for instance. Okay, 2 more cards. 2 more cards, guys. And this is going to be a cool set. So many beasts, though. 3 mana, Vicious Fledgling. After this minion attacks a hero, adapt. 3/3 beast. Oh man, that's scary. Like, so you play that in the Tempo Hunter or Zoo deck. And it'll quickly become like a 3/6 or even better. If it attacks twice, you just kind of lose the game. It's a high threat card, and the stats are okay. So, I think, like, as long as you have like a curve turn 1/2/3, that's going to be really good. This will also be a good arena card because it does have the potential of becoming like a 3/6 or a 3/3 Divine Shield. And if they don't remove it for 2 turns, they just die. Very scary card. Okay, and finally, Primal Fen Totem. 2 mana, 0/3. At the end of your turn, summon a 1/1 Murloc. So it's kind of like having a Mana Tide Totem. If you're playing an aggressive Murloc deck that can kind of control the board, maybe have some weapons, maybe have the Maelstrom Portal, and you just make it so that your opponent can never hit this totem, then it's sort of like having a Moros in your deck, but with Murloc synergy, which means that you can buff them up with War Leader or Cold Light Seer and other things, and you can just kind of run them over with Murlocs. And because the new Shaman quest is a Murloc quest, this might be good in that deck. And then you get the Magafin out, and you just fill your hand with Murlocs, and then Murlocs for days, and there's just no way to stop all the Murlocs. Which is what Murlocs were kind of designed to do in Warcraft, right? Like, just overrun your opponent with massive numbers. I think this card will see some play in Murloc decks. I don't know about its applications elsewhere, but Endless Murlocs is definitely something to consider. It's something that your opponent wants to remove, so it might bait out a Frostbolt, and then you still up one Murloc, at worst. But you do have to maintain board control, that's the thing. And then we've gone ahead and seen some of the quests over here. Sulfuros is going to be crazy. It's going to Defiant Warrior. But, you know, some of these other ones have applications too. So just the way that Un'Goro is shaping up, Final Thoughts, so many beasts. I'm going to try Curator everything, obviously, because lots of good beasts means that you just need some decent dragons and maybe throw in some decent Murlocs too. So, like, Curator Paladin, Curator Shaman, totally possible things. Some of the quests, better than the others. I think that the Priest quest is weak, but the Warrior quest is godlike. Like, just defines how Control Warrior is going to play this set. All the taunts means that Pirate decks and really aggressive decks are going to have a hard time, but all of those players can just move over to something like One Drop Hunter, where you build up to that quest and you get 15 raptors that draw extra raptors in your deck. And I think that's fine, because it slows the game down a bit, but you can still play aggressively. You're still on the offensive with those Hunter decks. And I think that's part of what you know, those aggressive players are going to want to see. But for control players, there's definitely a lot of cool options in the set. And the quests really give you a lot of versatility in how you play things. You can either choose to play a quest deck, or you can choose not to play a quest deck. Like, Priest, for instance, you have, like, the Elemental Priest, which actually seems playable with Leer the Sun Shard and Radiant Elemental, and then they already have Lightspawn, maybe play Lightspawn. But they also have the Death Rattle version. And, you know, the 5-mana 8-8 taunt that sets your health to hero, to 40, maybe I am underestimating that. Maybe having 40 health is actually insane. And when you combine that with having Binding Heal, your opponent can just never kill you. They can never burst you down. So you just out-control them, and you kind of play that classic Priest style. And then you have interesting options, like the 5-attack and more things coming out of Druid. That's an interesting archetype, and it also allows cards like the 3-3 that becomes a 5-5 if you have a 5-attack minion on the board. It becomes a lot more playable with that, and then that would also be a 5-attack minion that counts towards this. So maybe you play both of those. Just a lot of really interesting options, and very powerful spells also in this set. So I'm thinking Un'Goro is going to be a lot of fun. At this point, I do think that there's a lot of competition towards the Jade Shaman and Jade Druid. So although Jade Shaman and Jade Druid may still be viable in the coming set, I don't think it's going to be everywhere in the meta. It'll just be kind of another deck that you can consider, kind of like what C'Thun decks became or what Yogg-Saron decks became. And yeah, hopefully we should have a lot of fun going forward in Journey to Un'Goro. So if you watched this far in the video, thank you very much for that. I'm sure it's been over an hour. I dread looking at the timer. In any case, I've been Dark Skeleton. Thanks for sticking with me in this channel. I'll try to have some Un'Goro content coming out for you guys. And of course, the next set that comes around, I'll definitely be reviewing that as well. So thanks again, guys, and I'll see you guys in my future videos.